Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this new day of life. Thank you for the opportunity to come together with fellow believers from all around the world and across this country, some that are joining us by live stream and many that have come here. We're thankful that you have a group of people that desire to study into these most precious truths that we as a church have been wrestling with for over 100 years. We believe that now is the time that they should shine in their brightness, and that it's time that the world hears this message. So I pray that as we study a little bit more this morning, that our minds can be turned to what Jesus has done on behalf and for each and every one of us. That we can be strengthened by understanding a faith that has never failed. And we pray that our eyes can be drawn to you. Give me your words. May your Holy Spirit speak to each heart. And we thank you for this opportunity in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, what we are studying this morning is a sacred story, talking about the faith of Jesus. You know, I can remember quite a long time ago, Pastor Bill Brace asked me a question. And he says, so does God have faith? I hadn't actually ever thought about that. And pondered it and thought, you know, God knows the end from the beginning. He knows everything. How can somebody that knows everything, what's going to happen, have faith? It was easier to picture that Jesus had faith when he took our humanity. But God, that was something that I had to wrestle with. A friend of mine, Dr. James Landis, who I worked with for many years up at Kettering, knowing that I had an interest in this study, had recommended a book called The Faith of Jesus by Richard Hayes. I looked it up. I was curious about it, but I still didn't read it. And then about probably 15 years ago, where Jerry and Fred and Lloyd and myself had the opportunity to meet what we called the Gospel Study Group with a group of seminary faculty up at Andrews. It was like our own little mini graduate course. Twice a year, we'd come together and study with the professors. Another one of them said, not necessarily agreeing with our understanding of the faith of Jesus, but said, you guys should look at this dissertation by Richard Hayes on the faith of Jesus. And at that point, we got the book, Fred got the book, we all started studying it, and it really crystallized in my mind this idea of the faith of Jesus. And so this morning, we are going to take a little deeper look at the faith of Jesus in a way that I haven't presented before. So there is some debate in the Christian world, among evangelical circles, about what does this word, faith of Jesus, mean? How should it be translated? The Greek is pistis Jesu Christo. It could be translated, as many modern translations translate it, faith in Jesus, and it can be translated faith of Jesus. So this raises a question, and if you look in your Bibles, and we're going to look at a few key texts here in a moment, those of you who have newer versions, the Revised Standard Version, the New King James Version, or the American Standard Version, often that will be translated faith in Jesus. Bible translators had a hard time comprehending, like I did at first, that how could Jesus, who was God, have faith? That's a human attribute. And so there's a debate that goes on. Is pistis Christo referring to Jesus as the object of faith, or is it referring to Jesus as the subject of faith? Does Paul, in other words, think that faith is something that Jesus has, or is it something that Jesus exercises Or does he think that it's something that human beings direct toward Jesus? That's what we're going to be looking at. And so just real quick, let's just look at our Bibles. Let's turn to Romans chapter 1, verse 16. A text that sparked in Martin Luther's mind the concept of the righteousness by faith. But Romans chapter 1, verse 16, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Paul was living in a time where Christians were persecuted. The Romans thought, whoa, who would believe in a God who would be put to death? That was a shameful thing. And Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first, but also for the Greek. For in it, what's the it? In the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. He's quoting Habakkuk. Paul is using scripture to make his arguments as he writes this. So the question already here is, if Paul's not ashamed of the gospel, what's the gospel? The good news. The story of salvation. The good news of what Jesus has done. Paul is not ashamed of the gospel because it reveals the righteousness of God, and it's revealed from faith to faith. Does our faith reveal the righteousness of God? If it does, it's very inadequate. Is there someone who lived a righteous life? Was there a just one who lived by faith? That's what we're looking into. And so let's flip over to Romans chapter 3. Let's look at Romans chapter 3, verse 3. For what if some did not believe? What are they not believing? They're not believing the gospel. Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect? Paul is building this idea that God has accomplished something, and it doesn't matter whether we believe it or not, it is true. And so down to verse 21 and 22. For now the righteousness of God, apart from law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is through faith. What does your Bible say? Okay, I'm hearing of. I'm hearing in. The of's are reading out of the King James Version. Everyone else is reading out of something else. Do you see the confusion that we can have sometimes just because the way one little word is translated? And that's what we're going to understand today. So, the righteousness of God apart from law is revealed. How is that revealed? He's talking about a single act of faith that revealed the righteousness. Even the righteousness of God, which is revealed through, and it wouldn't make any sense to say that the faith that we have in Jesus, and then to say to all and on all who believe, that would be completely redundant. You guys see that? It makes much more sense to say that the righteousness is revealed through the faith of Jesus. And then follow up with to all and on all who believe, for there is no difference. We can see this building over in verse 28. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith apart from the deeds of law. This theme is going to come back up. And down in chapter 4, verse 5, it says, to him who does not work but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. Paul is talking about here in Romans how Jesus justified the whole human race. Whether we believe or not believe doesn't change that fact. And so, he is building that case. It has to be built on the faith of Jesus. Romans 5, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Paul is building the case. He does it again over in Romans 5:18 as through one man, the text that Pastor Dinsey read this morning, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, which resulted in condemnation, even so through one man's righteous act. This morning we heard a sermon on the one man's righteous act. One man's righteous act is Paul referring to what Jesus did on the cross. And what I want us to understand today as we are studying the faith of Jesus, we could say it's his righteous act. We could also say it was his faithful act. We could say it was the faith of Jesus when he performed that act, which is to all men, which resulted in justification to life. So, what we want to look at today then is the faith of Jesus. And I'd like to, we may not have time to delve into it all, but I'd like to delve into the faith of Jesus seen as a gospel story. We already heard that this morning. I want to talk just briefly about a practical application and ultimately its final fulfillment. The phrase by Paul and also by John can and often does refer to Jesus' faith. But embedded in that simple phrase is much more than just the concept that Jesus lived by faith. When Paul uses that phrase, the faith of Jesus, pistis Jesu Christo, the faith of Jesus Christ, he is using that as shorthand. He's using it as a code phrase. He's using it as telling us that there is a story beneath the story that he is telling. And so sometimes there can be a story above the story that we can just throw on, hey, let me tell you a story that illustrates the main point. But in Paul's case, there is a story below the story that he is not expounding because his hearers have already heard the gospel story. They've already had the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They've been hearing the story. They've heard the story of Jesus. They know the story of the cross. And so Paul alludes to that story as he continues to explain his message. And so Paul does believe that humans are put into right relationship with God through faith. He does. He believes that humans are put into right relationship with God through faith. But it is not through their own faith. However, it is through the faith of Jesus. Paul isn't discussing theology. Paul is discussing a sacred story. And so when Paul uses this term, he is pointing our minds to think about what Jesus went through, what Jesus accomplished. And so it should bring to our mind the awful struggle that Jesus went through in the garden, as we were reminded this morning, and on the cross. So, how does Ellen White use the term? This is in the 1888 materials, page 217. The third angel's message is the proclamation of the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Dee mentioned this last night. The commandments of God have been proclaimed, but the faith of Jesus has not been proclaimed by Seventh-day Adventists of equal importance. Now, what does Ellen White mean by the faith of Jesus? She's just trying to make the point that Jesus lived by faith and that's it? She's also talking about more than just faith of Jesus. She says the law and the gospel. She's now saying that the faith of Jesus is what? The gospel. Going hand in hand. You can't separate those two. We're going to hear about that this afternoon. I cannot find language to express this subject in its fullness. The lady that wrote, who's considered the female who's written the most books ever, Ellen White, as a female author, can't find language to express this concept. The faith of Jesus. It is talked of, but it's not understood. What constitutes the faith of Jesus? That belongs to the third angel's message. Listen what she says. Jesus becoming our sin bearer, that he might become our sin pardoning savior. He was treated as we deserve to be treated. He came to our world and took our sins that we might take his righteousness. Faith in the ability of Christ to save us amply and fully and entirely is the faith of Jesus. Ellen White is using it the very same way that Paul was using it. That there's a story beneath this term. And we're going to see that John the Revelator used it the same way as she is highlighting right here. All right, so let's go over to Galatians. And so turn your Bibles to Galatians chapter 2. And let's start with verse 16. Galatians chapter 2, verse 16. We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, that's verse 15, verse 16, knowing that a man is not justified by works of the law, but by the faith, what's your Bible say? How come I'm hearing all this confusion? So I have edited my Bible. I have a New King James that actually says that it's through the faith of Jesus Christ. So, how are we justified? The faith of Jesus. Is Paul comparing, are we justified by the works of the law? No. That would be a work that saves us. Is Paul simply saying instead of actually doing a physical work and trying to keep the law that we should change to a mental work? Of putting our faith in Jesus and that now saves us? Could that also be a work? I put my faith in Jesus, therefore I'm saved. That's what our Bibles, some of your Bibles are reading, right? So, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Does that give you more security to think that your justification is based on Jesus' faith? Amen. Or more security to think that your justification is based on my faith in Jesus? We all fall into this trap. Grant mentioned it in his prayer. We all feel like I might not have confessed enough. I might not have had enough faith. It doesn't depend on my faith. And that should set us free. Time is flying. It's amazing what happens up here, Todd. So, it also wouldn't make sense if it said faith in Jesus even when we have believed in Jesus, because it goes from the objective to the subjective. It goes to our experience after the fact. And so that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of law, for by the works of law no flesh shall be justified. And so over in chapter 3, verse 2, this I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of law or by the hearing of faith? What is Paul referring to here? The gospel story. There is a story underneath Paul's writings. Some people think that Paul is just giving dry theology, but Paul is preaching the gospel. He just isn't expounding all the details because he knows his hearers have heard that. We don't have time, but if we look down in verses 6 and 7, he said that Abraham believed. Was Abraham made righteous because he put his faith in Jesus? Now, he might have had a vision showing to him of Jesus coming. He did know about the seed, but he didn't know Jesus as a personal Savior. But he was told the gospel story. And because he heard the gospel story, his faith was strengthened. It is by hearing. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so Paul in Romans 3 verse 2 says, by the hearing of faith, by the hearing of the gospel, by the hearing of what Jesus did when he lived by faith. That is what he is referring to here. And so, years ago, Lindy put this up, and I didn't even understand it. And I thought, I'm never going to explain it in these terms. But underneath this, my English teacher, Don, our English teacher, be very proud of me for even trying to do this. I can hardly speak English, let alone diagram a sentence. And I can't believe I would even try. But Paul is telling a story. And a story always has different aspects to it. And I won't get into the axis of communication and the axis of power, but there is somebody that wants to accomplish something, an object. And so he turns to someone, which in a modern story we would call a hero. And that hero usually has to battle things. He usually has an opponent. But to help him along the way, he also has helpers. We could put this into any story, any modern movie, any modern book is going to have not every last piece of this diagram, but parts of it. And so, whether he's successful or whether he fails depends on the help that he has and how strong the opponent is. Let's just look at an example from the Old Testament. God wanted to deliver his people from captivity. Who's the sender? God. God is the one that wanted to do this. God, and so, what does he do? He appears to Moses. And so Moses is the agent that he's going to use to accomplish the deliverance of his people from bondage, to lead his people out of Egypt. And Moses receives help. What was the help he received? He got his brother Aaron to speak for him. He had some signs when he put down his rod. It turned into a snake. He was able to tell Pharaoh of the miracles that were about to happen through the judgments that were to come. But there was an opposer. Who was the opposer? Pharaoh. And so there was a series of plagues, and ultimately the Passover and Israel crossed over the Red Sea, and Pharaoh's army was, should say, destroyed. As a result, was God's purposes accomplished? God's purpose was accomplished in this story. God wanted to achieve deliverance on behalf of Israel. And so he sent Moses, who was opposed by Pharaoh, but he had the help of Aaron in the signs and miracles that occurred. Does that fit the diagram of the story? If you were going to make a movie, you would want to start off with a storyline and you would want to fill it in. What did the Israelites do for themselves? This is a story about what God did on behalf of Israel by using Moses. So, let's apply this now to Galatians. Let's go over to Galatians chapter 4. God wanted to do the same thing for the whole human race. He wants to deliver the whole human race. And so Paul, In Galatians 4, verse 4, says, when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth, who's initiating it? God sent forth who? His Son, who was born of a woman, born under the law. What's the purpose? To redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. Do you see a complete story in that picture? God wanted to redeem or adopt the human race, those who are under the law. And so who does he send? He sends his Son. What was working against Jesus? He took upon himself our human nature that needed to be redeemed. But did he have something to help him overcome that nature? And the answer is faith. Jesus lived by faith. What's more powerful? Fallen nature or faith? Faith. Faith. And so God accomplished this in a mysterious way. Jesus has enacted our destiny. And those who are in Christ are shaped by the pattern of his self-giving death. In the prototype of redeemed humanity. So Paul can say that the faith or the faithfulness of Jesus Christ has an incorporative character. Jesus is not merely a good moral example. He's not just the Superman that swooped in to save us. Rather, his story transforms and absorbs our world. The old world has been crucified, and the new creation has broken in through Jesus' death and his resurrection. That is Paul's thesis through Galatians. Paul, when he is talking about the faith of Jesus, is envisioning what Pastor Dinsey took us through this morning. Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. He is sweating great drops of blood. And as the Mayo Clinic described the physical suffering, we're reminded that Ellen White says that Jesus hardly felt the physical pain. So great was the weight of sin pressing upon him. He felt that his sacrifice was going to be eternal. He could not see through the portals of the tomb. And so three times humanity, Jesus in his humanity said, Father, if there's any other way. But nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Was there any other way? There was no other way. Could Jesus have saved himself? As Pastor John this morning said that the devil wouldn't bother tempting Jesus if he couldn't truly be tempted. So just look over at Luke 23 real quick. Luke 23, verse 34. Jesus said, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they do. And they divided his garments and they cast lots. And so now he's on the cross and the people stood looking on. And the rulers with him sneered, saying, he saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ, the chosen of God. Could Jesus have saved himself? Certainly he could have saved himself. And the devil knew it, and he is tempting him even right now just to say, forget it. It's not worth it. And I didn't count on not existing forever. I am off this place. Let these people just suffer. There's not a single one of them that appreciates the sacrifice anyhow. But his faith wouldn't let him. Again in verse 36, and the soldiers also mocked him, coming and offering him sour wine and saying, If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. Jesus is being tempted twice. Once by the rulers, once by the soldiers, to save himself. And verse 30 says, then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. Jesus could have saved himself, but he couldn't save himself and us. And he had already decided that he would save humanity no matter what the cost to himself was. And that tells me that God loves me more than he loves himself. Amen. Jesus would rather not exist for all eternity so that I could live if that's what it took. That is a God who you worship. That is a God you can boldly come before the throne. Not fearful like a pagan God, like the pagans approach their God, but a God that loves you more than he loves himself. That is what Paul is asking us to see when he uses the phrase, the faith of Jesus, or when he uses the phrase, that righteous act. Or when he just says the gospel. Ellen White in Desire of Ages, page 756, says, amid the awful darkness, apparently forsaken of God. We heard this morning, God didn't forsake his son. But through the weight of sin, Christ could not feel his Father's presence. Christ had drained the last dregs in the cup of human woe. In those dreadful hours, he had relied upon the evidence of his Father's acceptance heretofore given him. He was acquainted with the character of his Father. He understood his justice, his mercy, and his great love. By faith, he rested in him whom it had ever been his joy to obey. And as in submission, he committed himself to God, the sense of the loss of his Father's favor was withdrawn. Did Christ die despondent and in despair, a defeated death? No. By faith, Christ was victor. Amen. What does this mean? This means no matter what your feelings are telling you right now, no matter what your experience may be telling you right now, that faith is stronger than that. Amen. Understanding how God had led him in his past was able to encourage him that God was still with him even though he couldn't feel his presence. Amen. This is the faith that has gone through the crucible of the Garden of Gethsemane. This is the faith that has endured the cross, despising the shame, and has come through victorious. This is a faith that has never failed. As Pastor Dinsey yesterday morning stated, that it passed every single inspection and there was no blemish. Whose faith do you want? Mine? Or his? This is the faith that he promises to give his people. So God wanted to redeem us who were under the law. He sent his son who was opposed not just by our fallen nature, but he was opposed by the devil. He was opposed by every single possible force. But despite every single possible force, his faith was stronger, and he overcame and saved the human race. This is the gospel story. Nowhere in the story are we in it yet. This is something that has already been accomplished on behalf of the human race. Your salvation is secure in Christ. It is accomplished. It is completed. Now, you probably can't see this in a lighted room, but Carl Sagan, astronomer and scientist from the last century, had a famous quote looking at this one little speck as Voyager 1 had gone way out into space, billions of miles. And they turned it around and they looked back at this pale blue dot, our Earth. He's famous for saying that we are in this vast nothingness of space, this little speck of dust in the universe, and there is no sign that any help is coming from outside. Carl Sagan did not understand the cross. The justification of man cannot take place upon the ground of an immediate relationship between the believer and God. The justification of man cannot take place upon the ground of an immediate relationship between the believer and God. Can't be dependent on my faith in him. He has to do something first. Faith comes by hearing the gospel. Faith comes by hearing what God has already done. The means of justification is Jesus himself in relationship to God and to man. He alone brings us into the right with God. By his faith or faithfulness, he is the true representative of all men. When Paul elaborates on justification, the faith of Christ is the means, and the faith of man, the faith of men in Christ is the purpose and the response. God always initiates everything about our salvation. We love him because he first loved us. It's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. Is it any different that we experience justification by faith because he has already justified us? And he is the author and the finisher of faith. He initiates faith. When we hear the story of his faith, it produces a response. And so that is what happens. Ellen White states, the soul-saving message, the third angel's message, is the message to be given to the world. The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus are both important, immensely important. And they must be given with equal force and power. The first part of the message has been dwelt upon mostly, the last part casually. The faith of Jesus is not comprehended. We must talk it. We must live it. We must pray it and educate the people to bring this part of the message into the home life. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, Philippians 3. What does this mean? Ellen White isn't concerned that we understand that, oh, it's not faith in Jesus, it's the faith of Jesus. It's much more comprehensive than that. How do we talk it? By recognizing that God is the initiator of everything, even in our day-to-day life. How do we pray it? How do we educate the people? And most importantly, how in the world do you bring this into your home life? So, just for a practical application, and I think all of these truths that we've been studying have practical applications, there's different examples we could use. If I say, Johnny, you are just like your dad, you're never going to amount to anything. Have I spoken reality or faith into Johnny? That's what I think Ellen White has in mind when she's talking about the home life. How do we speak faith into people? How do we speak faith into people's lives? God's word is powerful. It is creative. And so if we can see what Jesus sees, Jesus saw a pearl of great price, he was willing to leave everything behind to pursue in each one of us. If we see as Jesus sees, when I, as a doctor, look at a drug addict who just came in and woke me up at 2 a.m. because he snorted cocaine and now he has chest pain, do I see a drug addict who's just making my night terrible? And say, He deserves this. He brought it on himself. Why am I wasting my time with this guy? He's going to just go right back to it. Or do I see what Jesus sees? A pearl of great price that he was willing to die even for that drug addict. Don't have time to tell the story of John Radley, but you can read about it in First Manuscripts Release, page 146. Ellen White talks about how she treated a farmer who wasn't an Adventist, but she kept sharing all the plans that the Adventist church had and just treated him as though he was a believer. And a few years later, he was like, why does she treat me this way? I'm not a believer. But she saw him become an elder and a leader in his church by treating him with the faith of Jesus. Many of you know Keith Stokes. I probably won't tell it right, so you can talk to him afterwards. But a few years back, after talking about the faith of Jesus, he'd shared a story with me that struck me. And he talked about how, you know, when he was in the first grade and the second grade and the third grade, he hated math. He was terrible at math. Those of you who know Keith, he's actually an engineer. Do engineers have to know math? I don't know any engineering that isn't based on calculus and math and a lot of science. What changed? Well, Keith says there was a couple of teachers, but one in particular, when he got to academy, said, Keith, you're really good at math. You have a natural ability for math. He didn't experience that. But it changed his whole course, and he became an engineer because a teacher saw something in him that he didn't see in himself. Was that a fair assessment of the story? Close enough, he's saying. But all of us can look back at people that put faith into us. That is the gospel story. E.J. Wagner says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word of God gives life to the dead, and life is salvation. But a dead man cannot feel anything. The word awakens him to feeling. But a live man does not by any means always have the same feeling. You therefore receive the living word of God and you will find life. Then, no matter what your feeling may be, you will know that you are saved. How do we know we are saved? It's by the word of God. A.T. Jones had a lot to say about the faith of Jesus. The faith of Jesus is that God set his son in the likeness of sinful flesh. The faith of Jesus encompasses almost every topic that we could talk about. It talks about the cross experience. It talks about God provided justification to the whole race. It talks about that Christ had to come in our nature that needed to be redeemed. It includes all of that. It's a comprehensive phrase when Paul uses the statement, faith of Jesus. A.T. Jones says, the true faith, the faith of Jesus, is that, far off from God, as we are in our sinfulness and our human nature, which he took, he has come to us just where we are, that infinitely and pure and holy as he is, and sinful and degraded and lost as we are, he, in Christ, by his Holy Spirit, will willingly dwell with us and in us to save us and to purify us and to make us holy. This isn't a story about a superhero that just came, delivered us from sin, and then left us in our condition. This is about the three angels' message of the cleansing of the sanctuary that wants to purify our hearts within. He goes on, he states, the faith of Rome is that we must be pure and holy in order that God shall dwell with us at all. But the faith of Jesus is that God must dwell with us and in us in order that we shall be holy or pure at all. Do you see the contrast between putting the focus on my faith versus Jesus' faith? Every single pagan religion has as its premise that I need to do something first in order to stand in favor with God. But the 1888 message and the message that God gave to our church to give to the world was different. While we were yet sinners, helpless, unable to save ourselves, then we're all in that condition. Christ died for the ungodly. Amen. Jesus Christ is the initiator and the finisher of our faith. So A.T. Jones again says, and this is the faith of Jesus. This is the point where the faith of Jesus reaches the lost, sinful man to help him. For thus it has been demonstrated to the very fullness of perfection that there is no man in the wide world for whom there is not hope in God. No one so lost that he cannot be saved by trusting God in this faith of Jesus. In this faith of Jesus, by which in the place of the lost, he hoped in God and trusted God for salvation from sin and power to keep from sinning, this victory of his, it is that has brought to every man in the world divine faith, by which every man can hope in God and trust in God and can find the power of God to deliver him from sin and to keep him from sinning. Amen. Jones packed a lot into a sentence. That faith which he exercised and by which he obtained the victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil, that faith is his free gift to every lost man in the world. And thus, this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And this is the faith of which he is the author and the finisher. Amen. Do you want a weak, untried, untested faith that we have? Or do you want the faith of Jesus? Amen. That's what A.T. Jones is saying, that Jesus is giving to every one of us. And so the faith of Jesus is participatory. It's not something he just did apart from us and left us to ourselves. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 2. Paul sees this clearly. I have been crucified, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Some of you need to edit your Bibles to read the truth in a more powerful way. Paul sees that because of what Christ did, Christ is now going to do the very same thing in my flesh. Has Christ experienced an overcoming my flesh? Yes, he's already conquered it with a faith that has never failed. He says the same thing in Romans 5. We read it this morning. But we looked at it already, so I'm going to skip over that for the interest of time. But in a mysterious way, Christ has enacted our destiny. Those who are in Christ are now shaped by the pattern of his self-giving death. He is the prototype of humanity. So for Paul, the faithfulness of Jesus Christ has an incorporative character. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me. Jesus is not merely a good moral example. Rather, his story transforms me. It absorbs our world. This is the message that God commanded to be given to the world. The old world has been crucified and there is now a new creation. So consequently, we have to understand, let me just put this quote. Consequently, we have to understand that the phrase pistis Jesu Christo, my translator here had a hard time with Greek, pistis Jesu Christo should be understood as a concentric expression which begins always from the faith of Christ himself. But being Seventh-day Adventists who believe in the cleansing of a sanctuary and entering into a final work with Christ, it includes necessarily the answering faith of believers who claim that faith as their own. God has given us an unshakable faith. So, we're going to close with a text that we all know, Revelation 14:12. This is from the English Standard Version. Here is a call for the endurance of the saints, those who keep the commandments of God and their faith in Jesus. Or what my Bible says, the New King James Version, here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Is there a difference? Is there a sense in which this one is true? Yes, but it's only in a response to this one. Which one has the power? This one. There's going to be a cleansing of the sanctuary. God will have a people who follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. It is the capstone text, Revelation 14:12, that indicates that God will have those who will keep responding to his faith and love with faith and love. In the face of all the powers of wickedness that operate at the end time, as these three powers unite to form the end time Babylon, God will have those who overcome. Here are those who keep the commandments and the faith of Jesus. We are to keep two precious gifts from God. The faith of Jesus is no more my faith than the commandments of God are my commandments. God gives them to us. Jesus is saying to human beings in the end, at the midnight hour, my plan for you is still the same. Go and sin no more. Keep the commandments. I know you are sinners. I know you're incapable of doing this on your own. So the only way you can do this is to realize that the power of my faith will work in you. I see you as victorious. Do you believe my faith? Jesus has not given up that despite five generations of unbelief, the fact that we are still here as Seventh-day Adventists, he keeps bringing this message back. God will have a people who will stand in the end time with a response of faith and love. Will you follow the Lamb? Quote that we heard this morning and again last night, as the will of man cooperates with the will of God, it becomes omnipotent. Whatever is to be done at his command may be accomplished in his strength. All his biddings are enablings. Father in heaven, all we can do is say thank you. You have pursued us when we were without strength, when we were your enemies, when we were ungodly. In your faith will never let us go. Amen. We see that our faith is weak, that we often grow cold, but you will always hold us fast. And you have a good grip and won't let us go. Father, my prayer is that we can begin seeing others the way that you see us. There is a world out there that needs to know that you are their Savior too. And may we be willing to be a part of that last generation that gives this message to the world as you have called, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.